Take your butt. Oh, whoa, what? Oh, whoa. That's enough. What?
That's enough.
It's enough is enough.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another episode of Dragon Coffee.
Oh, yeah.
We are going slowly but surely going through the classes of Dungeons and Dragons.
And our minds.
That is beyond the point. I'm not going to talk about what's going on in this little head of mine, but it's not the greatest of things to talk about.
Squirrels.
Today, we are talking about the spell casting.
Which one?
The spell casting that comes from the book.
Which one?
It comes from the book.
Wait.
A book.
The Bible?
No, a book where you write down your spells.
The Bible.
A spell book.
What if it's the Bible, though?
What? No, it's not.
What if it's their Bible?
Where are we going with this?
What if it's their Bible?
I mean, it could be. If that's just a weird way of putting it.
How?
Welcome to Wizard.
What? Wait, am I a wizard or are you a wizard?
I'm the wizard.
Harry!
So, sit down, relax.
Pull up a Harry Potter book.
Sure.
And also some coffee.
As we get into Wizard today. So, today, we are going to use the glorious Trixie as an example here. It's just a lot easier for us to do that than using Tetra Cube.
Hey, who's Trixie?
But Tetra-Cube/D&D, really great site. For randomizing your wizard, we're going to do Trixie today. Trixie is a drow wizard that I play on the show AC2 High. Tal'Dorei campaign. We'll get into that during the break, or at least the slight break that we have, where we just kind of go over our side projects, but we'll be using her. She is a drow wizard that I happen to play. We'll just be using her as an example. So, we will go ahead and I will use the base stats that I used for her off of my character sheet. So, for a wizard, The basic idea of a wizard is it's a spellcaster that learns things while every other spellcaster in the game gains
inherits them from BS.
The wizard is the only class where you are literally gaining it through your brain.
They forced knowledge down their throat in order to slay thine enemies.
And at the end of the day, it turns out to be the best option because you become the most powerful spellcaster.
If you live past level 9.
That's why I'm the tank! I'm the tank of the group. I'm the tank. I'm the wizard that's a tank.
Most wizards go glass cannon. Trixie does not.
I don't, because I want to live. And plus, that was the idea of the character anyway. So, we'll be looking at the stats that I have for this character. I have an 8 in strength, minus 1.
Ooh, so powerful.
And it's just the way it is. I have a 15 in dex, plus 2.
Oh, so powerful.
Wisdom is a plus 2.
Oh, so powerful.
Charisma is a plus 1.
So powerful.
And then the two stats that we're going to be looking at heavily here are Constitution, which is a 16 plus 3. And my intelligence, which is currently at a 19, originally was an 18.
And so
a
powerful.
Plus 4.
It's because it's so powerful.
Now, I am a wizard.
Visor.
That goes for more of a protection route. So I am an abjuration wizard. I focus more on spells that protect myself and my team. Granted, with a wizard, I don't think there is a thing as just like, you get all the spells as a wizard, right? Because
basically,
you
I mean,
use what
most
I,
of the most of the things you get restricted from is I believe druid and ranger. Lots of druid and ranger spells you don't have access to.
Yeah, but for the most part, I have access to all the spells. I will just have to spend all my money on them, but that's okay.
Yeah.
That's what you spend your money on as a wizard. You don't need anything else. You need spells. And that's where really this power spike comes in, because you have all these different spells. And then at the end of the day, you have like the most spell slots at the end of the day. It's just, you have a lot. It's just a huge power spike. The saves that they have, or like the things that they are proficient in, are intelligence and wisdom.
They have a D6, big fat D6, and their weapons are daggers, dots, slings, quarterstaffs, and light crossbows. So basically, they don't use any of those.
Nope.
Because you have cantrips.
Why would you use any of that?
If you don't know about cantrips, go ahead and look at our warlock video. Talk some more about that stuff.
Or spellcasting in general. We have a spellcasting video.
Yeah.
You can look at that as well.
That too. Mm-hmm. Look at that, guys.
Episode 2, spellcasting. You can look at that.
You guys are doing good.
And that's where we really dive into cantrips the most.
Oh, yeah.
So, the cantrips I do have with her are Firebolt, Lightning Lure, Mage Hand, Message, Shocking Trip, Shocking Grass, and Thunderclap. And those will be my bonus
actions. Thunderclap. Thunder.
Thunderclap.
Thunder.
Thunderclap.
Thunder.
Thunderclap. I Thunderclap squirrels.
Thunder. Oh, yeah, of course. I mean, that's what Thunderclap is actually designed for. You know, get rid of squirrels.
Exactly. We basically put a little bit more flavor on her, and basically, she is an abjuration wizard, but, like, she has these set amount of points that I can use within every level that allow me to create a spell by spending one of those points. I believe it's 3 points each level. So yeah. I can literally create 3 different spells each level. It just depends on the materials that I have and the idea that I'm going for.
Yeah, because creating spells is honestly very... It's counterintuitive sometimes because most of the spells that you want are already out there.
Pretty much.
In some form, shape, or way. But usually when it comes to homebrewing spells... very hard to balance them, so you usually make them weak at the beginning and then strong at the end. That's how I would go with it. It's fine if you just bump up the damage. It wouldn't make sense story-wise, of course. But you can say, hey, the character's just learning it, so that's why it was weaker. Or whatever the case is. But just make it weaker before you make it stronger. This way... it meshes well with the rest of the game. Using the template from another spell that already exists that's similar to it is always the best route to go.
Agreed.
Yes. Okay. That too, guys. That too, and more. Oh!
Is that your guy?
Yeah.
So, as we continue to move forward, shit. What she's proficient in is Arcana, Insight, Investigation, Medicine, Perception, Sight of Hand. And I mostly use my Perception for everything because I went a...
Sight of Hand from your background?
Sight of Hand from my cantrip.
Oh, dodge one. Yes, mm-hmm. Yes, yes. Sticky Fingers.
Sticky Fingers is a cantrip that I do now know. Gets me proficiencies. Frick.
Frick a frick or fry a cracker.
Well, it's best to just pull up Wizard in front of us and then go off of that. Because.
Alright, yes, I have. Yeah, of course.
Mm-hmm. I pull it up right now as well, and we can just go in off of this instead of just going off of my brain because it's a
off
lot
the
easier.
Brain hole.
Because I know all this shit, it's just. I gotta keep it in my mind.
Hell yeah.
Spellcasting, we already went over what spellcasting is, exactly what he said. Her DC is. 8 plus your proficiency plus your intelligence modifier. So whatever your proficiency is currently, our proficiency is at 3, so that would be 11 plus my intelligence, which would make it a 15. Because you plus 4 that intelligence, and if I throw a saving throw, or I cause someone to make a saving throw against me, they would have to get a 15 or higher in order to pass. So that's all that is. Then it goes into how the book works, and they have a spell book. Now, that's the bread and butter of a wizard, is having your spell book, because that is what you can copy your spells in. And it costs money. I believe it costs 50 gold. Yep, 50 gold, and the process takes 2 hours to put the spell in your book, but... you know, you got another spell. And
exactly.
And after a while, I mean, like, I've gotten to the point in the campaign where I have a lot of gold, and I can just throw that throw that at money. I literally, the last time I got some spells, I got 5 spells, I got it at full price, and I was able to put all of them in at the same time, I mean, over throughout the day pretty much, but given how that works, but with that gold. So I got 5 spells, so spells within spells, this spells, within the day.
Stock up on spells. The only thing is that preparing your spells is the only thing that's like a crutch when it comes to that, because you can only prepare a certain amount of spells
each day, but it's after a long rest.
Indeed.
It's after a long rest. Every long rest you can prepare, you can wake up and prepare different spells, but it's just, that's how the nature of the beast goes.
The nature of the beast.
And then we have arcane recovery. You have learned to regain some of your magical energy by studying your spellbook. Once per day, you can finish a short rest. You can choose expended spell slots to recover. The spell slots can have a combined level that is equal to a less than half of your wizard level. And none of the slots can be 6th level or higher. For example, if you're a 4th level wizard, you can recover up to 2 levels worth of spell slots. You can recover either a 2nd level spell slot or 2 1st level spell slots. So basically what they're saying is, I'm Trixie, I am a 6th level wizard. If I use arcane recovery, I can literally, while I'm using a short rest, I can get either 3 1st level spells, 2 2nd level spells, and then 1 1st level spells, or I can get 1 3rd level spell back.
Which is always comes in handy. You might as well use it once you've depleted your spells. If you know you're going to get into another combat, say for instance you're in a dungeon, just assume if you're in a dungeon, you're probably going to fight something.
Exactly. And there's just a lot to go over. With Wizard, there's actually not a lot of things you get because you are gaining spells. You're getting spells throughout the entire campaign, and you're doing a lot more than you actually think you are, given how it looks on the page. Because you're just like, hey, I don't really have that much. But if you're consistently grabbing spells and you're just consistently able to prepare different spells, you're doing so many different things than what you normally are doing.
I suggest keeping a cheat sheet that has the damage dice and the type of the damage dice, as well as the type of save and how it scales. That is probably just the best way to really do it. And also the area of effect. If it's an AoE or if it's a cone or anything of the sort, just keep those as a little reference. After a while, you will get used to the spells that you commonly use. But as soon as you add another spell, whoop, you have no longer remembered any of the other ones.
Mm-hmm. And actually, I think because of how quick this actually might go, we can do a build along with this. That way, we can mostly because granted, we can use. She's already built, so we already know what this character is. So we can build another character, and there's not much to go off of Wizard because literally it's spellcasting. You got arcane recovery. You at 18th level, I believe, you get spell mastery. You have achieved such mastery over certain spells that you can cast them at will. Choose a 1st level wizard spell and a 2nd level wizard spell that are in your spellbook, and you cast those spells at the lowest level without expending a spell slot when you have them prepared. So basically, you can essentially use them as cantrips without using a spell slot, but cantrips work differently. You're able to just use them at will. So just say you have, let me look at Trixie, if she lives to 18, I would bring a spell like, there's too many 1st level spells. Mage armor would be a great one to just be able to always have up. Pretty much.
Mage armor.
And if we're going to 2nd level, I could probably consider going. Let's see here, from what she has known, something like. There's a lot of, like, 2nd level spells are really great too, though. Detect Thoughts would be broken, but still. There's just a lot of options.
Yeah, Detect Thoughts is very dependent on who you're using it on.
True enough. It's one of those things where it's just like, there's a lot of options. And then at level 20, when you reach 20th level, you gain mastery over two powerful spells and can cast them with little effort. Choose two third-level wizard spells in your spellbook as your signature spells. You always have these spells prepared. They don't count against the number of spells you have prepared, and you can cast them of each at third level without expending a spell slot. So essentially, you just can cast without expending spell slots from 18 to 20. And it just goes up from 1 to 3. It's okay, but it's still OP. It's strong, but it's alright. We can go into abjuration, but like literally all it is with certain things is that with the wizard subclasses, it's based off of the... I'll use abjuration as an example. I'm going abjuration with Trixie, so abjuration spells cost half for me to put into my book.
This would be the same for each school that you go into?
Pretty much. And then you get extra shit afterwards. But it depends on the subclass you're going. And then that's really it. That's really it as far as wizards. So let's just do a build along.
This is very simple, yeah.
It's very simple, but very fun. If that's the way you want to do it. So we'll do a build along to make it a lot easier for you guys. Go ahead and pull up the site.
I've already rolled.
Tetra-Cube. You go ahead and start on the grandma coffee.
Alrighty. So I've rolled up a character. It's a very interesting one so far. It is an Arera Krokra Vizard, School of Divination. And they're apparently an anthropologist. Ooh. Their occupation is a farmer or a herder. So it's an Arera Krokra that is a herder. Chasing around them doggos, chasing around them sheep. As an Arera Krokra.
Oh, wait,
we got an Arera Krokra? Arera Krokra, farmer.
God, what?
Or herder. So, Arera Krokra.
Okay,
let's On the plantation.
Living among violent people, I have become desensitized.
Violent farmers.
Farmers.
They slaughtered their pigs. Well, and cooked them up.
Boats make me sick. Adopted culture. Oh, it's just...
Lizard folk farmers. So he was adopted by lizard folk farmers.
That's a stretch. Long straps of leather on which spells are written, wrapped around his staff for ease of transport.
Yeah, so he just literally, interesting. He just, his staff is his conduit.
That's really cool.
He literally just looks at his staff and says, Avjevla Bandorgia!
No, that's really cool.
Yeah.
That's a good way of doing it. Hi,
I think this, using this would definitely give you interesting spellbook material, because spellbooks are very unique to each wizard. Say, for instance, for whatever reason, you have a...
I have a diary-like thing.
Yeah, so hers is basically in the form of a diary. It's probably written in code and longhand, shorthand, and basically. And so what I always thought was an interesting conduit for a spellbook was tattoos. I always thought tattoos were probably the most interesting way to convey a spellbook. Basically being a walking, talking spellbook. It just sounds unique, it sounds fun, but it sounds very limited. Yes. So it's so much space that you have on your body that you can write things on. But it is still a cool and interesting idea, though. And so the its high ability is Charisma, Persuasion. They're forceful, they're a born leader. Mannerisms are chewing... like chewing on something. As an Arera Krokra chewing on something. An Arera Krokra chewing all the time would really sound very annoying. Because it would literally just be like loud snaps. And I was...
What the... this is such a weird build.
It is.
Okay, so you're at...
this is...
Interaction trait. Irritable.
So they just sound like a really grumpy asshole...
They really do.
Yeah.
Value slaughter.
Yes.
Drawn to a special place.
A special place. I can be whatever you guys want.
Okay, so this guy just has mental issues so far.
Yeah. Flaw or secret?
Specific phobia.
Okay, let's run this over. A farmer who is a divination farmer, a rara crocra, who gets seasick on boats, was adopted by lizard farmers, who's always chewing on something, like tobacco. A tobacco-chewing rara crocra wizard divination anthropologist specialist. Yes.
And he likes to slaughter people. Down to a special... He's also drawn to a special place.
Yes.
The specific phobia must be water, because boats make him seasick.
He could be perfectly fine with it, but not like it. But his phobia are small squirrels. Squirrels that are abnormally smaller than normal size squirrels.
Why? That's very specific.
That's his specific phobia, right? Yes. Yes. Specific.
He's an anthropologist. His appearance. Nervous eye twitch.
So he chews on something consistently. His eye is always twitching. He's always used to slaughtering people.
How is he charisma?
I mean...
How's he charismatic? That makes no sense.
By force, it says. So he persuades people through force.
So you just have a high intimidation skill.
Yeah.
Charisma persuasive, forceful.
Born f***ing leader.
Wisdom oblivious.
Absent-minded. He is literally... You guys would be discussing an entire plan... And he just go, Leroy Jenkins, I have a divination. I have perceived the upcoming battle. We win the upcoming battle, then he just leaves. This is a guy, this is a character right here.
He sounds like some... You know what? You can see him, and he is unique. Yes.
And his eye is always twitching, just...
His eccentricity, your fashion sense and grooming, or more accurately lack thereof, sometimes cause others to assume you're a beggar.
So he
looks like a poor ass.
He's a poor, eye twitching, gum chewing farmer, lizard folk having basically mentality.
Okay, so this is one of the example of just every random thing now making sense put into a character.
Yes.
So there you go. He's 8 years old.
He is a young boy. I'm a young boy.
He's an 8 year old?
Yeah. I mean, they mature very fast.
I'm sure they do. When I became a wizard, became lost in a forest, a hedge wizard found me, took me in, and taught me the rudiments of magic. What? Why?
So he was going around slaughtering people, and he lost track of time during this time. No, hedge wizards are terrible, actually. No, they're actually supposed to be good.
That's what I thought.
Hey, you know, in some lore, they're bad.
Who fucking knows anymore? But you found him. Oh, wait, his alignment's chaotic. Good. Really?
Yes. He only slaughters those who deserve it. I slaughter you and no sympathy.
I mean, at least there's that.
So apparently he was like, Papa Kling Klang. Because lizard folk, as if you guys don't know, they name their people after sounds. The sounds that they make the most. So if you meet a lizard folk, and you are cutting down the tree, they'll call you.
Which is stupid, but
I guess interesting at the same time. I love it. Lizard brains, right? Anyways, yeah. So physical characteristics. He's a short 8-year-old, 104 pounds, black, piercing eyes with a plumage of red feathers. I see it's red because of the blood. that is soaked into his body, and it is now just precipitating through, and it's showing so through it his feathers. Exactly.
So you see it as a crow. Is it a crow? What kind of bird is it?
Birdism? Wow.
What kind of bird is him?
He is a raven, but his plumage is red because of all the blood.
Why is it a raven? Because you like ravens?
No.
Everything's got to be a raven in D&D, huh? Because yeah. Of the Raven Queen?
No.
Make her a crow. He's a crow.
Why is he a crow?
Why does it matter?
Why is he a crow? I mean, it matters because this is the
crow
character.
Crow and a raven.
Crow and a raven had babies.
No, I'm just saying crow or a raven.
Raven. Crow. So he's a raven, basically.
They're pretty much the same kind of bird.
No,
though.
They're really not. Crows are really stupid.
Indeed,
crows are stupid.
It doesn't matter what kind of bird.
Crows are so stupid.
Anthropologist, by living among violent people, I've become desensitized to violence. Discovery. I want to be the first person to discover a lost culture.
That's actually interesting and unique. No, none of my players, neither have I, have ever said that.
No, that's really cool.
Huh.
That's a great ambition. He has a trinket that I believe is a key to finding a long-lost society.
Oh, that's so cool. Oh, that's interesting.
I'm like, this site's really great. This site's really great. Like, if you really don't know what you're doing with the character, you can find something real quick with this site.
I mean, I think he's just being an archaeologist in that case.
I mean, like, that's really cool.
Yeah.
Boats make me seasick.
Yeah, it's the same stuff.
Yeah. Birthplace, home of a healer or a what? Okay, whatever.
I mean, that makes sense.
It's okay. Absent parents. Your parents were imprisoned, enslaved, or otherwise taken away. You are in a poor fucking household. Childhood home, rundown shack. Childhood memories. I had a few close friends and lived an ordinary childhood.
Just filled in slaughter.
Click.
Oh my god, it really is. Wait, the Aurora Croaker, though.
Yeah, they're Aurora Croaker.
Well, I mean, technically, you don't have to know about them. You don't have to know they exist.
Exactly. Alignment, neutral, occupation, Utterson, alive and quite successful.
Ooh.
He is friendly. He is also younger than him. Dekik.
I didn't know they had such weird names. Kleck, Dekik.
Yeah, they're birds still.
They're birds, after all.
Female. Race, Aurora. Alignment, neutral. Farmer or herder.
Ooh.
Alive and quite successful, friendly and younger. So he has some friendly siblings.
Friendly, yeah,
his siblings aren't
him.
Assholes.
They're unlike him.
Yeah, he's a dickhole.
Yes.
Apparently. Life events. Arcane matter. Your fortune was read by a diviner.
And then rolling and all that good stuff.
Yeah, I don't need to go into that.
Yeah.
Job. You spent time working on a job related to your background. I mean, it would be anthropologist.
Yeah, Josh, stupid.
War. You survived the battle, but you suffered from the terrible nightmares in which you relived the experience. Great.
Great. Nice.
This guy's got so many issues.
He is just screwed. He has, okay. He started off as a young Aurora Croaker. Later on in life, 2 years down his life path, his parents were enslaved.
Oh no, Kupaka.
He was just nothing but a pup. He traveled the world until he came across a village of lizard folk, where he then adopted the name. Has to scroll back up. Which, apparently, these guys were farmers. And on their plantation, they grew pigs. They farmed pigs. They were constantly killing and eating the pigs that they tended to. Shut up, Wilson!
Kinda why?
Shut up, Wilson!
I'm acting it out, dude.
Oh yeah, no, I can see you're doing good. And so eventually he found his way into the forest deep one day, going on a hunt with Mama and Papa Lizard Man and Lizard Mama. They took off more than they can chew.
No!
There were several boars, two times their sizes, charging, rushing in and killing Mama and Papa Lizard.
No!
Wounded and his wings battered from the combat, he stumbled further into the forest, surviving off of the land, cherishing every meal as if it was his last, where he then came across a hedge whiz. Hello, I'm Samith. Oh, do you not? Oh, it is okay. I will teach you my language eventually. I have a lot to work with. I have a lot to work with.
There you go.
He taught him many, many things. But then...
Farm!
A draft came in. Both him and Sam were forced into a draft. And with his natural innateness to be desensitized to violence, he fit right in. He was happy to be there, being able to use his newfound powers as a wizard.
Farm!
But then, Sam was struck down by a gigantic meteor.
What?
That destroyed most of the encampment. The war was lost. The battle was inevitable. The enemy side took heads, women, children, cabbage patches. No, not the cabbage patches.
No, not the cabbage patches.
He said as he shouted, running away. He was then, later on, scouted for his talent in survival, thinking that he is the best of the best, not knowing that he's very absent-minded, and he just didn't actually make it out to the battlefield, which is why he lived. But he tells people otherwise.
I lived in that war!
And he's forever plagued by it.
I lived the war!
He was then scouted by Mistress Seraphine of the highest order, which he then began his adventure.
Wow, you guys really love that, I can see.
What a terrible character, and I love him.
I love him.
What a terrible, lovable character.
Lovable, terrible character.
Oh, Slaughter, 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 Slaughter.
So, we're building this fucker, right?
Yeah, bro.
God bless America.
Bless America!
Alright, well, here we go.
Here we go. Up in what we gonna build? I don't know. Divination. Divination wizard. Don't forget that.
I won't.
Divination.
Divination. No, I won't.
Yeah, divination. Divination. Divination wizard up in
wizard air crookers get plus two to dex and plus one to wisdom.
Yeah, he gets nothing that he needs.
Nope.
Hey, I mean, he's gonna be a dexterous wizard. That's gonna be a very interesting build. That's what I'm going for, buddy. What do you mean? Of course
I shouldn't be doing that, duh. You're the stupid one.
You're the stupid one.
I went to some random stats.
Alright, I'm gonna go get my coffee. Right.
This guy's got insight.
Woo!
Investigation.
But he has bad wisdom, though.
He does have bad wisdom. I can't change that. I can't change that shit, dude. Okay.
Okay, I'll change it. Arcana history. He's good with history and knowledge. He didn't take good to the Arcana, even though he knows it. He's good with medicine, though. I'm just giving a random grab.
She moves.
Oh.
And I said she bangs.
Grew what?
That's his name? That's terrible.
Yeah. It's literally O-O. It's literally O-O-R-R. It's O-R.
It is. It just said, yep. You're not wrong.
My name is O-R.
Alright.
But you can call me O-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-R-
you understand what we do here. Standard array, simple.
Oh, yeah?
So, he has shitty wisdom, so we'll put the 8 and wisdom.
Oh, yeah. Get that big fat 9.
He was good with charisma, right?
Yes.
15 in charisma.
Ooh.
No. 15 in intelligence, 14 in charisma.
Yeah, that's good. That's fine. I mean, he's not to be the most persuasive.
Mm-hmm. We still need to have his intelligence high. Even though it makes no fucking sense with him.
One day we're going to run a campaign with all these characters, and you guys are going to be like, why did you do that?
Yeah, and it will be our... It's like showing you guys that you can run these things.
Yeah.
And I don't know who would want to use this character. Oh, wait, I'm looking at him.
Hmm?
He would run the crap out of this guy.
Love saying his own name.
Yep, so 10 to strength, 13 to dex, because you get a plus 2.
He's going to be a dex wizard.
Dex wizard.
12 to constitution, 15 to intelligence, 8 to wisdom, and 14 charisma. Give him what we've been given. So, Arcana.
Arcanania.
An investigation, because he is an anthropologist.
He is an anthropologist. After all, he wants to find that secret society, which that is just so cool.
I really like that. That part
is so cool. That is such a good background right there.
How do you spell Ur?
Uh-oh. I'll give you some time.
Okay.
R-R.
R-R.
Yes.
Terrible. Oh, my God. Ur! Don't name your character this.
No, why not?
I don't know why that's an option, but it's hilarious. I will say that. It's funny. Try not to name your gadgets, though. Don't do it. Not I say divination, wizard. Half the gold time cost to copy school spells, influence future attack rolls, saves, and checks. Receive aid from those who share your faith.
Yes.
Alright, going to level 3. Alright, going to level 4. This is wizards, I'm telling you.
Basically, portents, though, the level 2 stuff, it's essentially speaking, it is a trait that I believe is like, it's a spell, actually. No, is it a spell?
What?
Rolling 2 dice and then replacing them. I think that's either a spell that's already in the game.
What are you talking about? Divination wizards?
Yeah.
Let me go pull up divination. I don't have it in front of me.
Okay.
We were not prepared. We just kind of did it on the
way. I have it. When you choose a school, you get the glimpse of the future to press in on your awareness. When you finish a long rest, roll 2 d20s and record the number followed. You can replace any attack, saving throw, or ability check made by you or a creature you can see with the foretelling roll. So you are literally predicting the future or not really predicting, but really kind of twisting and bending it. Similar to that of,
Well, I don't think that's a spell. I don't think that's a spell. What, like what?
I don't remember right now.
It would be a higher level spell, though. Definitely not.
Either like... it's a spell, a feat, or it's a race trait. I can't remember, guys.
It's something in the game already, but it's really good still. It can be really helpful when trying to cheat the DM.
Yeah.
That's the best way of saying it. Level 6. Level 6.
Casting divination spells comes so easily to you that it spends only a fraction of your spellcasting effort.
Really?
When you cast a divination spell of second level or higher,
what?
Using a spell slot, you regain one expended spell slot.
That's dope.
The slot you regain must be of a level lower than the spell that you cast and cannot be higher than fifth level. So you can literally refresh your spell slot. And this doesn't have a limit to it.
No, it's the same thing with most wizard subclasses. A lot of wizard subclasses don't have limits.
So you cast a divination spell.
You get another spell slot. You spend a spell, you cast a spell, you gain a spell. That's how that works. That's stupid.
You can literally just you could just literally get the spell slot back that you lost.
Yeah, so it's
and
just,
then cast it again over and over again.
It's like you can use that certain spell. You don't lose the it's so stupid. I love it. I love stupid things.
Wizards of the Coast.
Thank you for that. That's really great, actually.
Remember, this is D&D Player's Handbook, 5e edition. This is handbook stuff, guys.
That was in the handbook?
This is the handbook stuff, guys.
Oh, my God. Alright, well, 10th level, starting at 10th level, you can use your action to increase your powers of perception. When you do so, choose one of the following benefits, which lasts until you are incapacitated or you take a short or long rest. You can't use the feature again until you finish a short or long rest. It's called the third eye. Pretty much, you can get one of four abilities. You can gain dark vision. Wait, do you get all four? Yeah, you choose one. You gain dark vision out to a range of 60 feet, which is stupid. You can see into the ethereal plane for 60 feet of you. Greater comprehension, you can read any language.
Any language!
I would get that. See invisibility, you can see invisible creatures within 10 feet of you all the time, pretty much.
So this is just using your action to do so.
Pretty much. So you can get all four. You would just have to do... You would just have to use one until a short or a long rest. You can get back after a short rest.
Yeah, you can just switch them. Oh, no, which lasts until you're incapacitated. Okay. So you can just, you literally just use one, switch, use one, switch.
Which is stupid. The Divination Wizard, it's pretty cool, actually.
Huh.
So you can be like, I can read it after a little bit, just let me, oh my god, I know it.
See invisibility. That's it's pretty strong.
Most creatures can go invisible. A lot of them do.
Especially later on, later levels.
Starting at the last one you get, starting at 14th level, the visions in your dreams intensify and paint a more accurate picture in your mind of what is to come. You roll three d20s for your portent feature rather than two.
So I literally just... DM, I want this 15 to be my attack.
You got it, asshole.
I want this 7 to be the enemy's attack.
No.
I kill you.
No, I don't understand.
Actually, is it for any creature for portent? Or a creature.
Yes. A creature.
That means enemies and allies are...
Yep.
Huh. Wow, yeah, so I can literally just destroy an entire team of enemies by rolling all natural ones.
And those three are there. Those are theirs. You sure about that?
DM, all of them get ones.
All three of those guys, yeah, they get ones.
No!
Yeah, they do. I foretold the future. I seen it. I seen it, bro. I seen it. It was really great. Wow, this is an interesting character.
He killed me because he's a stupid strong guy. He's like Goku of wizards.
Yes.
That's the way I can see this guy. He's like the Goku
he's
of
like,
wizards.
He's like, I can see all of your punches. I dodged them all.
But how? I don't even know how I'm doing this. Oh, I don't even know. I don't understand, but I do.
Sam is dead.
Oh.
No, Sam.
Fucking hell.
I miss you, Sam. Sam. He really misses Sam, though. I think that's what's driving him.
If you want to play this character, name him not.
I mean, who knows? That could be really fun at your table, you know?
I mean, people would fucking love that.
No,
but at
yeah,
the same
definitely.
Time, don't do it.
He'd be a very lovable character.
If you ask
do
me
it.
If you want to do it, I say no, but you do what you want.
I say, guys,
do
follow your
want.
Dreams.
Do what you want.
Follow your nose! Wait, hold on, copyright.
How dare you?
Copyright.
How dare
you?
You
can't follow your nose. No one else can follow their nose, but you can, Sam.
All right, thank you guys for watching. We just went over the bases of wizards. Tomorrow, which would be...
Tomorrow.
Another episode tomorrow.
Another episode.
We will be going over a different class, so... Adios.
I mean, whoa. Guys, audience, that was
wait,
gross.
Wait. Before we go, let's discuss our side project while... Yeah. We have an alternative podcast that we run, and that is the AC2 High Tal'Dorei campaign. And on the Tal'Dorei campaign, what are you doing? You get the coffee?
Ooh. No, I'm just having fun with this.
No, the Tal'Dorei campaign...
the coffee.
...is a campaign setting that is run by Matt Mercer and his Critical Role crew that he basically put out several months ago. And we are running that campaign setting. So we're doing our own little campaign within their setting. And it's been fun. It's enjoyable. We're going through a little bit of a rough patch at the moment, but you know, once we figure out all of our little bumps in the road, we will be good. Everything's going great. So
and
check
you guys
that
are
going
to get some great, fantastic, amazing, splendiferous, wonderful content.
If you want to see what Trixie's all about, I didn't intentionally spill everything out.
Exactly.
Because we want you to go over there and watch.
We want you to go over there and stare at Trixie.
No. That's not what I want. Thank you for watching. See you
TY,
next time.
You guys are awesome. And also, you know what? I just want to say thank you guys for the support, for who has been doing the supportings and whatnot. Shout out to you guys. You guys are awesome. You know, we do it for you guys. But also for the ones who haven't yet done it, I'm looking at you, Thomas. Go ahead and hit that subscribe button. If your name is Thomas, go ahead and comment. And even if your name isn't Thomas, go ahead and hit that like button. But if your name is Thomas, you really need to.
Thank you, Thomas.
And don't forget to hit that toll of the bell for frequent updates. You guys are amazing. Awesome. Have some coffee.